üstün zekayı anlatan 3 halka üstün zeka modelini okulda çocukların becerilerini geliştirmeye yönelik okul genelinde zenginleştirme modelini geliştirmiştir. Renzulli, üstün zekayı anlamaya yaptığı katkıları ile tanınmaktadır. Joseph Renzulli, Amerika'da Connecticut Üniversitesi Eğitim Psikolojisi Bölüm Profesörüdür ve Üstün Zekalılar ve Özel Yetenekliler Ulusal Araştırma Merkezi'nin direktörlüğünü yapmaktadır. Araştırmalarında gençlerdeki üstün zekanın ve yeteneklerin yaratıcılığın tespitine ve geliştirilmesine, Topyekun okul gelişimi için organizasyonel modellere ve müfredat stratejilerine odaklanmıştır. Çalışmalarının odak noktası tüm öğrencilerin öğrenim seviyelerinin ilerletilmesine yönelik üstün yetenekliler eğitimi stratejilerinin uygulanmasıdır. Şu anda Amerikan Psikoloji Derneği üyesidir. Geçmişte Beyaz Saray Üstün Zekalılar ve Özel Yetenekliler Çalışma Grubu danışmanlığı yapmıştır. Son dönemde Connecticut Üniversitesi Mümtaz Profesörler Mütevelli Heyetine atanmıştır. Joseph Renzulli, kongremizi Skype katılımı ile özel misafirimiz olarak şereflendirmiştir. Yaratıcı üretkenliği geliştirme ve araştırma zihniyeti, 21. yüzyıl öğrencilerinin önemli talepleri.
I am very happy and honored to make a presentation at your conference and wish that I could be in your beautiful city in person. I also want to extend my greetings to my two dear colleagues that are there, Professor Ziegler and Professor Maker, people with whom I have had the pleasure and opportunity to work with many years. I will be giving you an overview today of the school-wide enrichment model, and there are probably far more slides in my presentation than I will have time to cover in detail. However, I have requested, and your conference organizers have agreed to make available a copy of this presentation. So even if I skip over some slides, you certainly will have the opportunity to get that information. I also would like to express my sincere thanks to Melody Oyapak, who has helped me in preparing this and has been kind enough to translate the slides into the Turkish language. So let us begin by putting the slides up. And start. Are the slides on the screen?
Slaytlar gözüküyor mu ekranda şu an?
Wait a minute, maybe I have to do this. Here?
Here, not in the Turkey. This one, slaytlar this one.
This one.
Slaytlar gözüküyor mu şu an ekranda? Ekranda slide var mı şu an?
Oh, let's get
var, this. Var, okay, okay. Yes, we should do a slide show.
Are the slides on the screen?
Yes.
They are. The focus of our work has been the development of creative productivity.
That's English. Türkçe versiyonu açmak için biraz bekleteceğiz sizi.
Yeah.
And this one.
And are we all set?
Yes.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. I will try to give you a few examples in just a couple of minutes of what I mean by creative productivity. But I wanted to begin by mentioning this slide and the importance of creative productivity for the economy, the social advancement, the cultural advancement of a nation. In this modern time, many of the important companies and organizations obviously want to get very smart people to work with them, but they are emphasizing the fact that thinking skills, innovation, flexibility, creative productivity, the ability to work cooperatively with others are the most important characteristics that they're looking for in their modern day learners. I have six topics that I will try to cover. First of all, we'll begin with a little general background. And one of the things I want to mention is that my work is based on more than 40 years of research conducted here at the University of Connecticut and in other places around the world that have done research on this model. All of this research is on our website, which you see on the screen. And if you go to that website, please feel free to download and reproduce, translate any of the material that we have developed without cost. There's no cost involved, and without having to gain permission. And I think that the most important thing about information, if it has value, it should be able to be very easy for people to have access to. Now, this next slide really has to do with something that everybody in education already knows, and that is that all learning exists on a continuum, and that continuum ranges from deductive and didactic and prescriptive on the left to inductive, investigative, and inquiry-oriented on the right. Now, I'm not saying that the left is all bad and the right is all good. We have, in my work, though, focused on the right-hand side of the model. And if you'll note in the footnote, obviously, we want young people to learn all of their regular lessons very well. But in the lower right-hand corner, we see exactly what the outcomes are as far as the kinds of students we're trying to produce: inventors, designers, innovators, entrepreneurs, people who make a difference in the areas of work that they do. And so people sometimes think that I'm not in favor of acceleration. I am very much in favor of acceleration, but I believe that even in accelerated courses, we must provide young people with material that leads to creative productivity. In other words, what I'm asking is that we have a balance between book learning, compliance with state ministry curriculum requirements, and preparation for standardized tests, but we also must be putting some emphasis on creative productivity. Now, this work is based on a theory of knowledge, and a paper has just been published on this, and I may have sent these papers ahead of time. Did I send them? And you might want to take a look at those. But before I cover the three areas of knowledge, I want to mention very briefly that young people get their knowledge in one of two places, and one place is in books. I'm going to move this down for a minute. In all of the books that they study in their courses, which is obviously very important. But in today's modern world, all of that information is easily available through the internet. And I call this just-in-time information. You'll see some examples of that as we move along. This is information that you only go and get when you need it to solve a particular problem. And that's the way that all adult professionals work in any creative or innovative or entrepreneurial activity in which they are engaged. So we start, whoops, why is this not? So we start with the first area, and that's basically received knowledge. That's what usually comes from textbooks and what children learn in their courses, and obviously that's very important. The second is what has become very popular in recent years, and that's analyzed knowledge. And if your education information is anything like it is here in the States, you've been receiving a lot of material about thinking skills, creativity, and those kinds of things. Now, these two types of knowledge have no value in and of themselves until they are brought to bear on some applied area. And so the idea behind this simply is that blended knowledge really represents all three of these areas working together. And there's no sense learning about names or dates or facts in history unless you're going to do some kind of a research paper or PowerPoint or start a blog that relates to Turkish history or world history or any other kind of history in which the child might have an interest. And so the outcomes of this, again, achievement always first, thinking skills, but most important for me is what is at the bottom of this page, which is the visual, oral, written, presented, performed application of knowledge that comes from the three circles. Now, my work over the years has been based on four theories. I did send you an article that describes these theories. Today, we will be focusing mainly on the two major theories. The first one having to do with the characteristics of giftedness, and the second one, what are some of the things that we can do to modify our classrooms and our work with young people with high potential. So one of the other things I want to mention here ever so briefly is that these are the two articles that I sent you beforehand. Re-examining the role of gifted education covers the four theories, and the article at the bottom is the one on the role of blended knowledge. And again, that's all easily available to you. Now, the next thing I want to point out is that these four theories have given rise to what I refer to as the school-wide enrichment model. This is a different brand of learning, again, from the deductive, didactic, prescriptive practices that take place on a daily basis in most of the classrooms of the world. And the model is divided into three parts. In the front of this cube, we see the three things that are what we call service delivery components. They're the things that we do with young people in various situations. The first one is comprehensive strength assessment. We want to look at all of the strength areas of the students. I'll show you how we do that as we move along. The second is curriculum modification for high achieving students. Many years ago, I developed a process called curriculum compacting, which we will be describing. At the bottom of the cube, we have the pedagogy that guides our model, three different types of enrichment. Now, we try to infuse these things into the regular curriculum, into a special organizational approach that we call enrichment clusters, which, by the way, is the most popular component of our model. And if you're going to start this type of program, I would suggest that you begin here. And then the other is anything that organizationally, after-school programs, clubs, extracurricular activities. On the right-hand side of the model, we have various resources that my colleagues and I have developed over the years to implement this model. And so you have this as startup. You can also add your own creative contributions to the kinds of things you do as long as you pursue what I refer to as the three major goals of the model. Today, we will be focusing on these three things. And again, the enrichment cluster is a very important and popular part of our model. Now, the goals of the SEM are very simple. The first one is enjoyment. One of the things that we all know from our own life's experiences is that anything we enjoy better, we work at harder and we do better. For schools, if we can get enjoyment into the heads and hearts of both teachers and students, your school will improve immediately. Enjoyment leads to engagement. That is, kids are very involved in what they're doing. They're excited about what they're doing. And this leads to enthusiasm for the act of learning itself. Learning is an enjoyable act. I think we've taken a lot of the enjoyment out of it simply because we put too much emphasis on memorization and preparing for tests. Now, here's an interesting fact, and I'll show you some research on this as we move along. But follow-up studies that we've done on the school-wide enrichment model show that it actually improves regular school achievement. And so this is one of the great selling points of our model. Kids can enjoy school and their achievement goes up. Now, this next slide points out how our model differs a little bit from other models in gifted education. The first is that we provide general enrichment, type 1 and type 2, to all students. Type 1 is exposing students to new issues, ideas, concepts, names, dates, events. It could be a cartoon in today's newspaper. Type 2 enrichment is a series of thinking skills that have been categorized into six areas and which we try to infuse into the regular curriculum. Please also note that the enrichment clusters are open to all children and all faculty participate. Type 3 enrichment is individual and small group investigations of real problems. And I've been asked 1,000 times what makes a problem real. I will define that in a little while. But I like to describe, and also compacting is a part of this as well. I like to describe type 3 enrichment as the young person thinking, feeling, and doing like the practicing professional, even if they're doing it at a more junior level than a physicist from the University of Turkey or a filmmaker from Hollywood or Bollywood. They're doing what the big guys do. They're only doing it at a more junior level. And so you will see examples of this as we move along. And we'll do that right now. So what do I mean by creative, productive giftedness? I'd like to share just a couple of examples with you. And we're going to use Triad here as our guide. So we see here a young girl named Kylie. And this happened right, this started right in the regular classroom. And here is an example of the type 1 enrichment experiences. Her teacher was teaching a unit of study in science on insects. And Kylie got very interested in insects, and she wanted to do a study about ladybugs. In the interest assessment device that we use to look at student strengths, one of the things that we found was that Kylie liked to play board games, games like Monopoly or other board games. Is that coming across? She decided that she wanted to develop a board game, and it's called the Ladybug Game. So now this is where, remember I said thinking, feeling, and doing like the practicing professional? Well, how do we give young people those skills? Well, one of the things that we do is get them in touch with what we call how-to books and also websites on things like board game design. So here you see a game called a book called Table Games, How to Make and Play Them, the board game design book, Rules of Play. Here's one that is very interesting. It's called A Guide to Starting Your Own Business, because Kylie didn't want to just develop this game. She wanted to make it into a business. Here we see the outcome. This took over a year for her to do. She developed this game. There's a picture of the board game. And let's hear from a little bit about the game. And if you can interpret what the announcer said at the end, she actually was able to find a company that was interested in producing her game. It is now sold in stores that sell children's games and in other stores like in the U.S. like Walmart and Costco. Kylie, at the age of 15, has now enough money to go through 4 years of college in the U.S. And in the U.S., college is now $60,000 or $70,000 a year. So that's an example I like because it shows the characteristics that we'll be talking about later. This next example is about a little boy named Brooks McConnell. And the type one in this case was not even involved in school. It was involved at home. Brooks was watching television with his mother, and in that television set, and here you see the entering point is a non-school experience, and the type one was, in watching this program, he saw a little boy named Sam who has a disease which is called progeria, and that's a disease where young people grow old very fast. Sam is only 14 years of age, but you see he looks like an old man. Brooks went and talked with his teacher and said, I would really like to do something, because Sam said one of the things that made him very sad is he always wanted to ride on a roller coaster, but he wasn't able to, again, because of his illness. So Brooks said, I want to do something about that. And so we got Brooks a number of books on roller coasters and also a number of websites. And what he did was he built a simulator for a roller coaster. One of the things that he did was go on a roller coaster and sit in the front seat with a camera so that he could get the full motion. He also developed a jacket with many pockets in it where you could put weights and magnets, and a chair, if I can get the chair, one of those chairs that vibrates sort of to give you an electrical massage. And he eventually developed the simulator, and he entered it in the Connecticut State Science Fair competition, where he won first place. And he didn't stop there. He laid, and so this would be, again, an example of type three enrichment. The type two was all of the research that he did in order to get the know-how, the information that he needed to build the simulator. And he went and he contacted both roller coaster companies and also the owners of amusement parks. And these are some of the letters that he sent saying, would you be interested in having this simulator outside the entrance of the roller coaster so that people that have physical disabilities or people, older people with heart problems, they could go in this little room outside the roller coaster and actually experience a simulator, a roller coaster ride. And so once again, here we see an example of a young person who took an idea and did something with it all the way. There are some roller coaster companies now thinking about building simulators that they can put outside the roller coasters at amusement parks. Now, this next example relates to something I'll be talking about in a little while, and it's called enrichment clusters. That's groups of students who share a common interest and come together to work on that interest. Now, this story is about a famous landmark in the New Jersey state, in the state of New Jersey in the U.S. It's a canal with a series of locks. The locks were used to raise boats up over a small range of mountains. And as this narrator will tell you, each year over 100,000 New Jersey school students visit this site. In the school that was working on this, all of the fourth graders, I believe, that would be probably about 100 children, went to visit this place, which is called Waterloo Village. When they came back, the teachers then had what we call a debriefing. Who was interested in this? In what ways were you interested? Is there something that you would like to do as follow-up? So this is the arrow in triad going from type one directly into type three enrichment. So let's take a look at this, and you'll see what these very young children did actually to save a piece of New Jersey history.
One of New Jersey's top 10 most endangered historical sites caught the attention of a local fourth grade class Instead of watching the popular destination close for good, these students have taken on the challenge of saving Waterloo Village. Kimberly Wallace reports.
Every year, approximately 100,000 students make the traditional trip to Waterloo Village for an up-close look at history right here in New Jersey. When fourth graders from Stony Brook Elementary School in Rockaway visited the historical site in October, the one-day trip turned out to be a year-long project. Students expressed their concern about the imminent closing of the site for lack of funding and decided to do something about it. Since that fall day, the fourth grade class has attended public hearings and worked collectively with a marketing firm to research and present their case to other schools as well as state legislatures to stir public support.
The goal was to raise awareness about Waterloo closing and to help reopen it. We've been working on this presentation for a long time, and we didn't have play time, we really liked it.
They decided that they really wanted to do something. So after a little discussion, they decided that what they wanted to do was to raise awareness about everything that's going on and how people could get involved and how people could help. This presentation is what they decided to do so that they could meet those goals.
The children met with assemblymen, wrote letters, made posters, among other efforts to spread awareness about Waterloo's possible demise. The village was recently listed as one of New Jersey's most endangered historical sites. Teachers and administrators say the project was not only about saving Waterloo Village, but also learning life skills such as leadership, commitment, and communication.
It's been a wonderful process this year, and generated by children is really what made the difference. They've learned the process of learning about hearings and how the legislative process works. They've learned editing skills, they've learned persuasive skills, they've learned presentation skills.
In this project, we learned that one kid can make a difference. That if you try hard, you can get to your goal.
Waterloo was officially closed on December 31st, 2006. It remains closed, that is, unless support to save Waterloo achieves momentum. From Rockaway, I'm Kimberly Wallace, WNBC News.
And here again, I think you see a good example of what I referred to earlier as the three E's: enjoyment, engagement, enthusiasm for learning. And there are many other things that I'll be talking about related to enrichment clusters, but one is what I refer to as divisions of labor. All of the children are not doing the same thing. Some met with government officials. Some wrote letters to the editor of the newspaper. Some did photography. Some developed T-shirts, Save Waterloo Village. So one of the things about an enrichment cluster is it's not every child doing exactly the same thing. Now, we're going to take a look at the first item that was on the cube earlier, comprehensive strength assessment. Over the years, I've developed, or my colleagues and I have developed, a series of different instruments that look at children's interests, look at their learning styles, their preferred modes of expression, and their academic area strengths. And this is all in an article that I wrote, believe it or not, in 1977. It is the most widely cited article in the field of gifted education. It's called What Makes Giftedness: Reexamining a Definition. And again, you can find that in many places, but certainly at our website. Now, a lot of people questioned this when I first started it, because at that time, giftedness was only determined by IQ scores. And I came up with these three areas: above average, not necessarily superior ability, creativity, and task commitment. Think of that as a refined or focused form of motivation. The children, like Brooke, was motivated to work on that project in order to help the young boy with the disability. And those instruments have all been very popular. And later on, I'll point out that they have also been now digitized so that we can do, that children can answer and get a profile by sitting down and at their computer. Now, why did I do this? Well, first of all, I believe that many people, that the world has grown to recognize as creative, productive contributors to science, culture, society, were not necessarily in the top 5%. Here, for example, is Thomas Edison. You see him holding a light bulb. He was the inventor of the light bulb, the phonograph, of motion picture movies. He is still the person in America who has the largest number of patents for his inventions. And he was not a good student. He never went beyond the fourth grade. His teachers thought that he was mentally retarded, that he was not very smart. Here is Richard Branson, who is the founder of Virgin Airlines, has a severe learning disability. School was very, very difficult for him. But all of the innovations in airline in the airline business are the result of his creative ideas. This is a woman named Temple Grandin, and she has a very high functioning autism. However, she is the author of 15 books. She is the world's leading authority on the humane treatment of animals raised for food. And so these are all examples of people that if we only used IQ tests, or we only used achievement tests to determine whether they should be served in a gifted program, we would lose out on them. And here again, you see someone who everybody recognizes by his hat, and this is Steven Spielberg. School was very difficult for Steven Spielberg. His teacher kept telling his mother he belonged in a special education class for disabled learners. When he was about 8 years of age, his mother bought him a wind-up movie camera, a Bell and Howell movie camera. And after that, all he wanted to do was make movies. And of course, the rest is history. He has become probably one of the most famous movie producers in the world. So what we want to do is take a look at our total school population. And my last example is a new one, but it's a favorite of mine. This is a man named Sir John Gurdon. He is the 2013 winner of the Nobel Prize for Medicine. And he has a letter which he keeps on his desk that he looks at every day. And I will show you the letter. And we've translated it. Melody was kind enough to translate that. And basically, it says that it's written by one of his teachers, and it says he refuses to do the things that we want him to do. He'd rather do them in his own way. And he thinks when he grows up, he wants to be a scientist. And that is very, very ridiculous. And so here again, I can see why he keeps that letter on his desk. And I hope that he sent it to his teacher as well after he got the Nobel Prize. So we must broaden our search process, be more flexible in our search process, open the door wider for young people like Kylie, like Brooks, and like young Steven Spielbergs and young John Gurdons. So we come back to this again, the different instruments that we've developed over the years. And here's just some samples from these instruments that you see on the screen. And again, in more recent years, they have been digitized to make it easier for teachers to get the information. There's learning styles, expression styles. We've just developed a new parent rating scale where parents can also talk about things that their children are interested in at home or outside of school that the school might not know about. That is will be published next month. It's called the Renzulli Parent Rating Scale. And these are the different areas that we have tried to cover in what we again call comprehensive strength assessment. The idea behind this is an identification system that we've developed, and there is a monograph on this at our website that you can get for no cost. It's called Equity excellence and economy in identifying students for gifted programs. And what we've done is, obviously, we do want to take a look at our top learners, the top 4, 5, 8%, you decide on what that would be. However, we also want to use some non-test criteria, which you see over here, non-test criteria, and take other steps to actually look at these young people. So about half of our population are traditional high-achieving students. There's obviously a very important reason for that. But at the same time, we want to leave room in our program, in our services, for students that may not be in the top 3 or 5%. And it is for this reason that I also argue that we must have general enrichment for all students, because sometimes it's the general enrichment, the type 1 or type 2, that tells us about a very strong interest on the part of a student, and then encourage them to follow up on that interest, as you saw in my earlier examples. And so you can take a look at this at our website, and it's not very long. It's about maybe 20 or 25 pages long. Now, what we do with this information is we form what we call talent pools in the school. So we would have talent pools, as these haven't been translated.
No,
we would have talent pools in literature, language arts, the humanities, different sciences, computers, physical education, the arts, the social science. What you want to do is know among your student population, what are the strongest interests and strengths of students in these areas. Even within an area like the sciences, it might be biological sciences, for example, or it might be physics or chemistry or ecology or astronomy. So even within an area we call the sciences, there might be some children that like to play with frogs and cut them up and dissect frogs. And there might be some children that would never touch a frog, but they're interested in things like electronics or mechanics or optics. So the outcome of all of this is very simple, that we want all grouping and subgrouping for enrichment clusters and any kind of differentiation that we do in the regular classroom to be based on student strengths and interests. We can do more with any student by way of academic achievement and creative productivity if we always keep strengths and interests at the forefront of our decision making. Now, this next slide is something that I like to put on. I'm a bit of a mind reader. I know what you're thinking. How can I do this? I've got all of these children to serve, and some of them are poor, and some of them don't pay attention, and some of them can't read well. One of the things that we've done is we've taken a little hint from the commercial world. Every week, I get a personal letter from Netflix and Amazon, and they send me books to read or films that they think I might want to watch. Now, do they send me the billion books that have been written in this world just in English? Of course not. They send me books that they know I like to read because they have my profile. They know what I have bought before. The same also, buy a pair of shoes online and you're going to get a dozen or 100 shoe advertisements because they know that you're interested in looking at shoes. And so what we did was we developed a system electronically, and it looks like this. Students sit down at their computer and they answer a series of questions based on the instruments that I mentioned earlier, the Interestalizer, the Learning Styles Inventory, etc. And that profile is then read electronically by a marvelous search engine that has in it 50,000 high engagement enrichment resources. You'll see some of these in just a minute. And the idea here simply is that teachers don't have the time to personalize or differentiate for young people to find all of these resources. So like Amazon, like Netflix, let's just let electronics do it for us. I'd like to give you an example of this. This is a little girl named Valerie, and I need to go back here for 1 second. And after Valerie filled out this instrument at her computer, she got her profile back, and that profile lists her major interests in her major learning styles and her major preferred modes of expression. But let's let Valerie tell us her story.
Valerie Stickles, and I'm a sixth grade student. I am one of the people who tried out this Ranzulli Learning website, and it was a really great website. I got my profile back, and I am one who loves poetry, and I really love poetry, and on my profile, it actually said that I loved poetry, and so whenever I went on to my critical thinking or books, it was going to be all about poetry. On some poetry websites, they actually let me submit my work to contests and everything, and I haven't heard back from them yet because it's supposed to take a few weeks, but I can't wait to hear back, and so I'll hear back from my own email address. And I got helpful hints on poetry also. I got, there was a website where you could actually, like, go and type in your poetry, and then you could kind of have it revised, and they would tell you stuff. And so I did get to do a little bit of that, too, so it was a lot of fun.
So, again, here we see an example of the profile United States Constitution. I don't know if that Constitution is going to last with Trump as president, but it might. And the second is a unit of study on ancient Egypt. So let's start with the Constitution. What you're going to see on this next slide is four students. And at the top, you're going to see three different websites that the teacher wanted the students to use. So she sent them to these children electronically. She can make a group, she can send it, or he can send it to the entire classroom, or you can send it to just one student. So notice here that all of these are identical about the US Constitution. However, if you look down here, you'll see most of them are different. There's obviously a little repetition because on very broad ones like American history and things like that. But by and large, based on the children's interests and learning styles, they are also getting ones that are more personalized to their own profiler. So that's one way that the teacher can use this. Now, here we have an example of a teacher who is teaching a unit on ancient Egypt, and that teacher puts Egypt into her search engine. She also can pick the grade levels and how difficult the reading level is for different grades, low, medium, and high. And she found a site which was called Fun with Mummies. Now, when she clicked on the site, she liked it, and she thought it was very good. So she selected it, and then she sent it to her students. And here's just a picture from the site where students can dissect and preserve their own mummy. It's a simulation, obviously. They have the hook, they go through the nose and they get the brain, they put it in a jar, they label the jar, they then get the scalpel, they do incisions, they take out the organs, they put them in a jar and label them, then they glue, they paste, they wrap, and pretty soon they have their own mummy. And if you do this with children, they all want to give the mummy a name. Don't ask me why, but they feel like it's important to give the mummy a name. So this is, again, you can't do the kind of teaching that I advocate in the triad model without the use of modern day media. And there's so much out there now that children all over the world can access because of the internet. We move on to topic number four, a very quick overview of curriculum compacting. And as I'm sure this cartoon tells the story, that there are many of our children, very bright children and even average children, that are very bored in school. They're not interested in what's going on in school. And in this cartoon, it wasn't translated, but I'll mention it. It says, Susie, put away Moby Dick. That's a very big, thick book. It's time for you to review Silent E. My wife actually developed this cartoon because our daughter, by the time she got to first grade, was already reading the Harry Potter series. She learned to read by herself at the age of three. And so she doesn't need to do all of the worksheets on grammar and phonics and all of those kinds of things. So there is some personal humor in this cartoon for our family. Now, the compactor is a very easy process. We name it, prove it, and change it. What is the objective that you're trying to cover in a particular unit of study? The second is, can you show that a certain child or a small group of children have already mastered this skill? And one of the ways that we do this is by informal and formal assessment. If you're teaching a unit in spelling, for example, you can give youngsters the pre-test, the test at the end of a spelling unit, give them that as a pretest. And if they already know the words, or most of the words, be smart enough to give them something else to do. And this is where your own creativity as a teacher comes in, because you don't want to just keep giving them longer and longer lists of harder spelling words. Find out something within the area of language or literature related related areas that they might like to do. Maybe they might want to use their advanced vocabulary to do some creative writing. Maybe they would like to develop a crossword puzzle or a word game. Make sure that this is just not more meaningless repetition of the strength area. Compacting is the most widely used form of differentiation in the world. I'm going to skip up two slides. And item number five, and practical suggestions for implementing the school-wide enrichment model. And I think I'm going to skip this slide. Again, we mentioned earlier the three different types of enrichment, and here you see them nicely translated by Melody on the screen. These are just examples of some of the kinds of things that we do as we go about organizing enrichment clusters. So for example, here is a group of children that listened to the president of the Litchfield County, Connecticut Historical Society. And I would say that he talked to maybe 50 or 60 fifth grade children. At the end of it, we had a debriefing. We asked children who was interested in this. The man from the Historical Society said that there are a number of unsolved historical problems in that county, like what one old rundown factory used to manufacture. And these young people, look at the looks on their faces, look at the interest that they have. They wanted to investigate some of those things like real live historians. And again, we got them some how-to books. We taught them some interviewing techniques so that they could talk to officials about the buildings. They went, they took photographs, they drew sketches of the building, all of the divisions of labor, very, very different. This is an example of the debriefing sheet. You can obviously make your own, add your own questions. Anything I've done, you can modify as long as you get to the three E's. If you don't get to the three E's, then we're not on the same path. So anyway, we asked children these kinds of questions to see who wants to follow up. I want to move along now to type three enrichment. And here you see the six categories of type three. Type two. What we have tried to do over the years is to gather together some materials that have been found to be either well-researched or well-accepted by teachers. I call that teacher validity, that these are good materials and that children like them. And then what we have tried to do is to infuse these into the regular curriculum. And I'll give you just a few examples, and we'll start with creativity. Is this creativity here?
This is thinking seekers.
This one?
Thinking seekers.
Okay.
Yes, creativity.
Yeah. We'll start with creativity. This is a series of activities where we ask children, it's called alternate uses, what they would do with old tin cans, old paper bags, or old spoons. And the key to this is there is no single predetermined correct answer. And we see how many responses that children can come up with. And also we see if they can come up with a response that nobody else came up with. When I was doing this recently with one child, he said that you could punch holes in the bottom of the can and use it as a sieve to sift impurities out of water, which I thought was a very creative response. Nobody else came up with that. We have classification activities where we ask children what of these pictured objects they could put together because of common characteristics. Notice the pocketbook, the woman's pocketbook has a strap, the watch has a strap, and the earphones have a strap. The ear mufflers or earphones have a strap. So that was an answer that nobody else came up with. Another child put together the Chinese junk and the comb because of the parallel lines existing there. So there are a lot of things, the lamp and the refrigerator use electricity. So there are many, many different. The kangaroo and the little puppet are furry things. These two are animals. The idea, again, is that there is no single predetermined correct answer. This is another one, which is an unfinished story that tells the story from another point of view. And this is one that we call a story starter. We ask children to brainstorm the sights, sounds, and smells in a jungle. We also have one for a airport, one for a busy street scene. And they brainstorm that. Then we ask them to write a paragraph that makes you feel like you are in a jungle. And this is where children start to learn creative writing techniques. So that's a little bit about type 2 enrichment. Now, type 3, again, the highest level of enrichment in our model. People ask me always what makes a problem real. And you see the four things on the screen. The first is personalization of interest. The children who did the study of Waterloo Village, over 100 children went on that field trip. Maybe 12, 14 children decided to do the study to save Waterloo Village. By the way, they were influential in keeping funding to keep that place open. So the first thing is personalization of interest. The second is use of authentic methodology. You don't have to know this yourself, but you have to know where to find it. And so one of the things that we keep in our lab here at the Rinzulli Center is a whole separate section of just what we call how-to books. And I believe you'll see some pictures of these books in a few minutes. These are the skills that give the young person the tools to, as we said, think, feel, and do like the practicing professional. The third thing is that there's no existing solution or correct answer. So much of school is finding the right answer, and that's good. However, if we want to create creative, productive people, we have to give them problems that don't have a single predetermined correct answer, just like the type 2 activities that I showed you a minute ago in creativity. Last thing is that it is designed to have an impact on an audience other than or in addition to the teacher. So think of my earlier examples. Think of Kylie's ladybug game. Think of Brooks' simulator for a roller coaster. Think of the Valerie, the girl that talked about her profiler, she sent her poems into contests and competitions. So the creative, productive person is always has an audience in mind, again, other than or at least in addition to the teacher. And that's one of the reasons why in the database for our electronic program, we have a whole separate database of just contests and competitions, but also things like science fairs, things like in America, we have a local, regional, state, and national competition for what we call National History Day. In a couple of weeks, we're going to have here on our campus a program that I helped start over 30 years ago called Invention Convention, where children all around, make sure you go to that, children all around the state come up with different ideas for inventions. And we have local winners that go to the state competition. And just last year, that competition went national. There'll be a national Invention Convention, as there is a National History Day Convention. So again, why do children work hard to make their project as perfect as possible? Because they know it's going someplace to have an influence upon an audience. Now, this next, we don't have a set curriculum. Someone just wrote me and said, will you send me the curriculum for your program? We don't have a set curriculum. Rather, we build the curriculum around the child. We first of all find the interests of an individual or a small group, and then we begin the development of a thing that we call a management plan. Whoops, there we are. The development of a management plan where they sketch out their goals, what their audience will be, what resources. You'll see an example of these in just a minute. And the teacher's role becomes a coach, or what I call the guide on the side. We had, Mel and I had a little trouble talking about the translation of that, where you help provide children with the methodological resources, like the how-to books, like getting access. They have to go, give you a recent example. They were looking at the history of a mayor's term in office in a city in Connecticut. Someone had to arrange that on the mayor's schedule for the children to come and do the interviewing. The teacher had to arrange for parents that would drive the children to the mayor's office because they were very young children, teach them how to develop a series of interview questions. So that's where the role of the teacher comes in. And by the way, there are several great books on developing questionnaires and instruments. The next circle is feedback. This is where we come in as adults. And if we don't have the know-how to give feedback on, let's say, a scientific project, then we can look around other teachers in our school or parents or people in the community or somebody from a nearby college and university. We've used all of those different kinds of people in helping children to revise, to rewrite, to redo their work so that it gets to the highest level. And then, of course, the one that I think really makes the biggest difference of all is that they're always working toward some kind of performance, display, presentation, having their artwork hung on the wall and those long, long corridors in the airport. All of those kinds of things are actual examples. And to do that, again, we use the management plan. And what I've circled here are the important, the general area of interest, the specific topic. That's what we call problem focusing. These children were interested in the history of their town, but then they narrowed it down to just Victorian houses, houses built during the Victorian period, and how they could preserve them. And their audiences grew from local all the way to national audiences. It started with just two local, then it went county, and then two national audiences at the end. Yes. Yeah. Can they see
yes,
us?
Sure.
Okay. So here we see an example of a management plan. And basically, this is what I follow in my own research. Again, thinking, feeling, doing like the adult. When I'm working on a research project, if it has to do with underachievement, I say, okay, well, what within the topic of underachievement do I want to study? Now, your best friend in this area is what I call how-to books. And we have literally hundreds of them. And there is a book that is just a directory of how-to books. Now, the one that I've seen is in English. I don't know if there is something similarly available in Turkish. But here, for example, a student's guide to conducting social science research that teaches young people how to develop an authentic professional questionnaire, checklist, or rating scale, or series of interview questions. And there are many, many of these. Plays for Young Puppeteers, How to Make Pop-Up Books, The Animator's Handbook, Paper Engineering. This is one of my favorites right here in all the world. It's called The Kid's Guide to Social Action. How do you do? We use that, by the way, with the children that were working on Waterloo Village. They had to learn how to interview public officials, how to get records, things like that, how to debate. And we see more. How to start your own museum. There's a couple of schools that I've worked with in the U.S. that have actually started local museums. And these are how-to books on starting a museum. Now, we get to enrichment clusters. And basically, there are three characteristics of clusters. Non-graded groups of students who share a common interest, who come together during specially designated time blocks. You will have to figure out which time works best for you. When we did the research on that, most principals were willing to give us Friday afternoon because they said that was a very dead time in their school. We've experimented with different schedules. There is a guidebook on this. Grab me a cluster guidebook. It's up there, up in that corner. We do have a guidebook on it, which I strongly suggest because it's got, for example, it's the next one to it. What I found is that you have to do a lot of experimentation, but the thin one up there in the left. Yeah, that's it. Okay. Okay. So I'm not trying to sell books. But if you're going to start a program, start with enrichment clusters and get a copy of this book. It's available from Prufrock, Prufrock Press in America. And I think that if somebody like Melody is smart, they would make arrangements with Prufrock to translate this into Turkish. Okay, and the third thing, again, it's always directed toward the production of a service, a product, a presentation, something that will change the community or get other people entertained or interested in a particular topic. You see in the diagram of the triad, the arrow from type 3 going back up to type 1. Many of the outstanding type 3s of students have become type 1s from other students. Now, I'd like to give you an example of a high school type 3. And so we're going to visit this high school, and you're going to see a group of children that got interested in a particular topic having to do with recycling.
Styrofoam trays, we thought we could use these biodegradable trays instead. They are made out of unprocessed food pulp and bagasse sugarcane, both very renewable resources, and fully biodegrade in only 90 days. All we needed now was an idea in order to remain economically efficient. We brainstormed and crunched numbers until we finally thought of an idea. The cost to upgrade from styrofoam to biodegradable is only $16,700. Divided among the 180 school days and the 3,100 meals we serve every day, that is only 3 cents per meal. This cost could be offset many different ways, one of those ways being directly absorbing it into the student body. That is less than $1 a month, and equates to only $9 over the course of a school year. Other options include applying for federal grants or having the costs associated with the trays absorbed to the $113,000 that Winter Food Service made in profit last school year. However, the slight increase in lunch price is most plausible since the lunch costs will be increasing due to the food prices regardless. With the cost problem solved, we moved on to the tough task of pleasing the student body. The students were well aware of the tray issue at Windsor High and had already formed strong opinions about the trays and their environmental impact. When asked about the new biodegradable trays, an overwhelming majority loved the idea.
This will be better for the environment.
I mean, look at them. They're strong, they're durable, and biodegradable. I mean, how can you lose?
These are biodegradable, which is plus. So.
Oh, that was nice.
It's got a good feel to it. It feels pretty sturdy.
Not only were they excited for the new trays, but they absolutely despised styrofoam.
I hate these ones.
Sometimes these break during lunch if you have a lot to carry.
I don't think I'm able to carry it. They don't fit anything.
Yeah, no, I don't like the styrofoam ones. They're really clumsy. They have to break right here.
Yes, it's definitely bad.
They would make it worth it to actually bother going to lunch. Because I think styrofoam.
Teachers were also on board with the idea.
So,
are
they going to pay dislike those styrofoam?
Yeah.
Because they are bad for nature. It ends with the nature. Yeah, absolutely. I would do anything to get rid of that styrofoam.
To solidify these opinions, we held a tray day at our school, collected data on what the student body thought about these biodegradable trays. Each randomly selected student filled out a survey on whether or not they liked the biodegradable trays. The results were overwhelmingly positive. Over 85% of the students wanted to switch from styrofoam to biodegradable lunch trays. With this data to back us up, we went to the Winter Food Service Director, Dana Plant. She agreed to do further research on the biodegradable trays after hearing information from composting specialist Paul Gibson. We were able to get all the styrofoam trays and the bagel and wrap lines replaced with paper boats, which, while not biodegradable, are many times better for the environment than harmful polystyrene, which I hope comes as no news flash. These boats will be used during the transition phase between styrofoam and our ultimate goal, biodegradable trays.
There are so many things that this video illustrates. Just to give you one small example, or a couple of examples. Some children were more interested in the data. They did questionnaires when they said things like an overwhelming majority. They had statistical analysis. Some children were interested in just the videography of making the video. Some children were only interested in the music. What music will we use as background? And then they found out that in order to use music that's already recorded, you have to get permission. They had to write letters to the companies that own the copyrights, the rights to the music, and many, many different kinds of things that represent what I call, again, divisions of labor. When I see an enrichment cluster that everybody is making the same thing, I say that's not an enrichment cluster. That's a teacher's idea that all children should make a puppet or all children should take a picture. So within a cluster, always look for sub-interests among the group. That's the way real companies, that's the way the real world operates. Now, I'm going to just click on these next ones very quickly because you're going to get a printed copy. But the theme of this is that we want every child to feel special. And in order to do that, we have to look. I had a young boy who had serious mental retardation, but in a movie-making cluster, he measured distances because the camera had to be a certain distance from the object. When that little boy's mother talked to me one day, she literally was crying. She said, this is the first time that her little boy ever felt happy and accepted at school. So I'm going to just put these on. I'm not going to take the time to read them. I want to have some time for questions, but I will mention these very quickly. Key questions. What do people with an interest in this area do? Now, what do they learn? They're going to learn a lot in the process of doing it, but what do they actually do? Very important. What products do they create and or what services do they provide? What methods do they use to carry out their work? This is where the how-to books are going to be your best friend, or again, get a local expert that's an astronomer to come and give some advice to kids that are building a telescope. What resources and materials are needed to produce high-quality work? How and with whom do they communicate the results of their work? And then what steps need to be taken to have an impact upon an audience? If you're going to display some children's work, let's say, at a local shopping center or in a public building, then you're going to have to make a few phone calls, talk to people that are willing to give permission. And let me give you a hint. Whenever you're asking permission for anything, bring children with you. It's very important because people have a hard time turning down children. Now, I want to wrap this up with a summary and a few conclusions. And the first is, again, the rationale for creative, productive giftedness. In most countries, everybody's worried first and foremost about the economy. And they have to realize that an investment, not an expense, an investment in creativity, innovation, and among young people is going to contribute to their economy. And so that's what should be a part of every school's goal or mission. The second thing is, this is a study that was done by three economists in Holland. Now, I always ask American audiences, what are economists most interested in? And they can only answer in one word. And that word is always money. Okay. In this particular school, what happened was that I started this school in Holland over 25 years ago. They followed these children who are now in the early stages of their careers. What they found was they took more demanding majors in college, especially women in the sciences. They got higher paying jobs, they got better jobs, and so their scores, their grades were higher than a comparison school. They used an SEM school and a control group school with the same age children, but without the type of curriculum that I've been talking about today. So very, very important that this research was not done by me, because they would say it's like telling you my own grandchildren are more beautiful than yours. But it wasn't even done by psychologists or educators. It was done by economists. And I like this study. And by the way, the study is on our website. The authors have given me permission to put it there. You can download it, reproduce it, translate it if you would like. Now, we move along. We have had many, many discussions with people using our model that have been very, very successful. And one of the things that we've tried to do is summarize what makes this successful. And the first thing is knowledge about the model. And I think that you need to understand what this is all about. Again, there's a lot of material in print on this. And we would love to see, we're already talking about translating the enrichment cluster into Turkish. The second thing is that what I call common goals, unique means. this is not a highly prescriptive model like most stuff in curriculum, even curriculum for the gifted. They still tell all the children what page to be on what day. As long as you are pursuing the three E's, you're going to develop your own three E's, your investment, your ownership, your enthusiasm, by shaping the model in your own direction. Again, local resources. You might have somebody, a parent that's a great puppeteer, or a faculty member who's a great photographer, or someone else who is very interested in dinosaurs in your community. You have to shape it your own way. And then I can give a speech next year in Turkey with some of your examples in it. So I don't want a cookie cutter carbon copy of any program. The third thing is energy. What I say is work harder, not smarter. I'm sorry, work smarter, not harder. And again, this is where the use of technology comes in. You could never find all the resources that individual or small groups of children in your class would need to do a good type three if you don't use technology. The next thing, and this is a very important one, is teacher and administrator trust of one another. If the principal of the school is not knowledgeable about the model and willing to support the changes like scheduling time for enrichment clusters, this isn't going to happen. In the U.S., when the superintendent, that's the chief officer of a school district, a school of a whole town or city, when the superintendent asks me to work with them and implement the model, I insist that the principals, first of all, learn about it and agree that they want to do this, and secondly, that they come to all the training and they stay. Sometimes they poke their head in the door and then they go. If the principal's not on it, it's not going to work well. The next thing is celebrations of excellence. At the end of every year, we have a showcase. Some schools call them a type three fair. We invite the parents. We invite the television companies. We invite the newspapers. We invite all of the school officials. In the U.S., every school district has a board of education, and this is something we want them to see the pride in. And then finally, again, what we're trying to do is to change the culture of a school to make it a happy place. So we move on. What I call common goals and unique means. You've heard the expression, all roads lead to Rome, or we could also say all roads lead to Istanbul. But for me, Rome is the three E's. However, there are many ways to get to Rome. Here you see the map. You don't have to go here or here. Here you can go anyways. And so the idea behind this is that most innovations fail because we know more about what we're against than what we stand for. So we stand for the three E's. You saw the type two goals and objectives, the different kinds of thinking skills. Now it's up to us as a school faculty to figure out how we get there. I want to tell you one short story before ending. And this is called reverse engineering. During World War II, three American bombers, B-29 Super Fortresses, they were called, were forced because of problems, engine problems, or being hit by gunfire, they were forced to land in Russia. The Russians took those three Super Fortresses apart piece by piece, every nut, bolt, every wire, and they built their own Tupolev T-4 bomber, which actually turned out to be better than the American bomber. So we have a lot of material on, this is called reverse engineering. Look at what somebody else is doing. And that's why I use a lot of examples of schools and children's work in my discussion with you today. So there's a lot of material available related to what you see here that we've already done, material that relates to identification, rating scales, things like that, material that relates to the triad model, And so I end with this is just an example, two examples actually, of enrichment teams. In every school that we have this program, we form a thing called the school-wide enrichment team. And that's usually the principal and a small number of teachers that decide on things like what would be good type ones for our eighth graders, what would be good type ones for our second graders, and what type two materials should we be using in our fifth grade math class to help children like and understand mathematics better. Never make this the job of a one person, but a team that supports one another, give them different responsibilities. And this has worked out very well in schools. If you only have one person doing it and that person leaves the school or gets married or goes off to have a baby, the program will collapse. So you want a team of people who can make this work. And again, we call that the school-wide enrichment people, and get people that are excited about teaching, that have some good ideas, that want to play around to make their school not just a better place, but a happy place. So we end, here's you sitting out in the middle of the field all by yourself wanting to do something. A couple of my favorite quotes. This one is by America's probably most famous anthropologist, Margaret Mead. She says, "Never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world. Indeed, it's the only thing that ever does." So if you want to change your school, you got to get a small group, highly committed people, willing to put in the time and energy to make this happen. Another one of my quotes, favorite quotes, is by John Maynard Keynes. "The real difficulty of changing the course of any enterprise is not in developing new ideas, but escaping old ones. To make change, you must have a dream." So here you are in the middle of this field, and you're saying, "I have a dream to make my school a place for talent development." So never give up on your dreams, because I think that if somebody in your school, small group of people, doesn't have a dream that we're going to make this school a place again for enjoyment, engagement, enthusiasm for learning, it won't happen. I thank you very much for listening. I extend to you my very best wishes, and I will be happy to answer questions for whatever time you might have available. Thank you very much.
Deniz aşırı bir ülkeden kongremize engin bilgileriyle katkıda bulunan Sayın Profesör Doktor Joseph Renzulli'ye teşekkür ederiz. Soru cevap kısmını yönetmek üzere TÜZDEV Başkan Yardımcısı Sayın Nuri Özkan'ı sahneye davet ediyorum.
Evet. Arkadaşlarımız, efendim salondaki arkadaşlarımızdan Ece'cim orada bir hanımefendi soru sormak istiyor. Öncelikle teşekkür ediyoruz efendim. Birkaç dakikanızı alıp sizlere salondan soruları iletiyor olacağız. Melody Hanım'a da burada merhaba diyoruz. Evet. Hanımefendi soru soracak. Buyurun.
Merhaba. Ben Havva Nur. İstanbul Üniversitesi Üstün Zekalar Öğretmenliği mezunuyum. Size bir sorum olacaktı. Öncelikle her şey için teşekkür ederiz. Harika bir sunumdu. Pardon. Renzulli'nin üçlü halka modelini öğrendiğimiz zaman bize bazı yüzdelikler öğretilmişti. %98, %85 gibi. Sunumda ondan hiç bahsedilmedi. Bunu merak ettim. Bunu sormak istedim.
that? Yeah, one of the things is I don't know who's gifted. Rather, what I want to do is give more children opportunities in general enrichment, type 1, type 2, and enrichment clusters. And then I want to see how they respond to that to determine not if they're gifted or not gifted, but if I should try to provide them with support and supplementary services. So if you're going just by test scores, it varies from place to place. In the U.S., it's usually the top 3 or 5% on test scores. Interesting. No one's ever said top 4%, just 3 or 5. So my approach is a little bit different, and we're not ignoring those very bright, high-scoring children. What we are trying to do is to give other young people who may have their three rings together a chance to work with support because of their motivation, because of their creativity, because of their interest, because of the group that they would like to work with.
Efendim, teşekkür ederiz. Bir başka soru sormak isteyen? Evet, hanımefendi, buyurun.
Merhaba. Öncelikle verdiğiniz kıymetli bilgiler ve bize gösterdiğiniz yönler açısından çok teşekkür ederiz. Paylaşımlarınız dikkatimi çekti. O açıdan da teşekkür ediyorum kendi adıma da. Ben şu bakımdan bir merakım var. Acaba Türkiye'deki eğitim programlarını hani bu bakımdan irdeleme şansınız oldu mu? Bizlerin programları hakkında neler düşünüyorsunuz? Bunu bilmek istiyorum.
Schools there that use it. I think that you might want to contact
Gülşah Saran,
who studied with me a number of years ago. She would know if there are places in Turkey that are using that, as I'm sure when Melody gets back to Turkey, she will get some places started. But I don't know. You might want to contact again. Say her name again.
Gülşah Saran. Modeli incelememiş. O yüzden hani burada çalışmış olan, daha önce buraya gelmiş olan postdoc öğrencisi Gülşah Saran'la konuşabilirsiniz diyor. Kendisi özel bir model incelemesi yapmamış Türkiye'deki üstünlere dair.
Evet, teşekkür ediyorum. Başka bir soru sormak isteyen, son soruyu alıyorum. Evet hanımefendi, buyurun.
Öncelikle eşsiz bilgileri ve deneyimleri için çok teşekkür ediyoruz hocamıza. Bahsettiği kaynakları temin etmeye çalışacağız. Ben İzmir'de hem üstün zekalı olup hem disleksisi olan çocuklarla çalışıyorum. İki kere farklı olan. Küçük bir dilim ama en zor bir dilim olduğunu düşünüyorum. Yaratıcılıkları evet çok üst düzeyde ama özel öğrenme güçlüğüyle ilgili ne yapabiliriz noktasında dünyada bir model var mı bununla ilgili? Bu konuda bilgi almak istiyorum. Tekrar teşekkür ediyorum.
Or gifts in the dough. There have been some studies done with children with disabilities. In fact, it's become a very popular topic in the U.S. We call it twice exceptional. That is, they're very, very bright, but they also have some kind of learning disability. And this is not an area that I specialize in. I did one study that I'll tell you about in a minute, but there are some people that work in this area. You might look up the work of Dr. Susan Baum, B-A-U-M. She has written extensively on this, and there are some books that have been written on this, or at least some articles. I don't know if there's any entire books. A number of years ago, Dr. Baum and I and another colleague did a study of highly underachieving bright children. And what we did in this study was basically give them an opportunity to work on what you now know as a type 3 project. And some of these children, and some of them were hated school, they were in trouble all the time. And what we found was that not only did most of them, not all of them, but most of them do a very good job on the type 3, but it also improved their participation in their regular schooling. And so that study you can find in the literature, and the authors are Baum, B-A-U-M, Renzulli, and Hebert, H-E-B-E-R-T. That might give you some indication of the way that this is being approached with twice exceptional children. And you know, it's very important with children with disabilities, we find out what's wrong with them, what they can't do, what they won't do, what they don't like to do, and then we spend the rest of the year beating them to death with it. Let's find out what they can do, what they want to do, what they're interested in, and use that to develop their basic skills. This work is nothing but common sense.
Efendim teşekkür ediyoruz. Sizlere Amerika'dan İstanbul'a ulaştınız ve bizlere değerli bilgilerinizle katkı sundunuz. Sayın Melody Hanım Efendi'ye de teşekkür ediyoruz. Kongremizin hatırası olan Mangala oyununu size Melody Hanım'la birlikte ulaştırıyor olacağız inşallah.
Okay, thank you. Teşekkür ediyorum. Çok mutlu oldum.
Teşekkür ederim.